And in other news, Gabriella Sargenti has come out with a new announcement saying that construction yellow is the new color of the day. Welcome to Tales of Citizens. I am Bridger. I will be your host today. And that's right. That's right. Cold openings are a thing now. We're going straight to it. Screw it. We're not giving you 25 seconds of nothing. You're going to get full content in this show. That's right.
25 seconds of nothing.
This is the Star Citizen Show, asking all the deep questions. I am Bridger. I will be your host for today. And joining me, as always, I have my good friends. To my right, I guess, we have my good friend here, Calathulu. Welcome.
This is left on my screen. Hey, guys. How are you doing?
And then over on the left, my
other
left.
Side.
You're right.
The other left.
Gray, welcome.
Oh.
So we got a new sort of schedule that we're trying to abide to here. We were kind of slow on shows for a while, but we're trying to keep up our consistency again. And specifically, we're going to record the last Sunday of each month. And that is where you'll find us 7 p.m. Eastern time right here on the YouTube channel, the Bridger YouTube channel.
Yeah.
At a minimum. Yeah. If there's any big news, we'll certainly come and do more shows than that. And as soon as the game does start getting more things going on with it, then we will probably go back to a bi-weekly and then maybe a weekly show when the game actually comes out and we got a lot of stuff to talk about. So thank you guys for joining us, and we are basically going to go through our standard thing today. We got a little bit to talk about with 2.4 and the sort of roadmap that they've laid out, as well as some updates with the Caterpillar and the Dragonfly and some of the things that have happened in the last month. But before we go there, we usually like to start with what we call a Life in the Verse segment, where we take a couple of minutes just to talk to our various hosts here about things that they've been doing in and out of Star Citizen. So what have you been playing and or doing recently, Gray?
A lot of Overwatch, actually. Really enjoying that for the quick round-based stuff. You know, with the kid and everything, it's been a little hectic finding stretches of time. So, yeah, been enjoying that. And then actually a lot of 2.4. I've really enjoyed flying around in that, doing a lot of the ICC missions. Today I actually did a security guard job for the first time. I bothered going and standing at that post and shooting people. Had some poor bastard who came out there thinking, oh, I'll just use the computer. Didn't realize I was standing there with a shotgun. He never even looked at me. It was just one, two in the head, and he's done.
Well, surprise is the best way to shoot somebody.
It really is.
But that, it's been a lot of fun. I'm really enjoying that. And beyond that, I picked up a new bike. So, yeah.
Was it a Dragonfly?
Besides that.
Is it like something you pedal?
Yes, or, actual pedal.
Because bike can refer to two different... You're right, that's why I went there first. If you
and,
were like...
Well, with the rain and all, you thought it was ideal to get a bike to go in the elements. Yeah,
that's why you need fenders.
You. Midwest, I would have assumed a Harley or something. So,
but the other thing that's worth noting, yeah, I do live in Seattle, so for folks who are looking to... yell at me in game, it's Seattle under Gray. Gray was already taken. So if you see me flying around, that's me in 2.4.
Underscore. Seattle underscore Gray. It's not Seattle under Gray, although that would be a great wordplay for you. You want to make like a some kind of riddle out of your name, you can do that. But
if I could manage that, yes.
Yeah.
So let me make sure of something, because you do live in Seattle. It's not a fixie, right?
No.
Okay.
No, God, no.
I have not been able to determine the reason that anybody tries to feel self-important by having a bike with no gears.
You've already answered your question by saying the fact why people try to feel self-important.
I ride a unicycle. I don't tell you.
Well, I guess that is a form of fixie. If it's not fixie, then you got a problem there.
No, I've got like 27 speeds on this thing. Ooh. I live on a giant hill, so there is no way I was going fixie.
Yeah, I'm assuming Shimano gears and all that good stuff.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Hydraulic discs.
Oh, perfect.
Yeah.
So I've been, obviously, for anybody that's following the channel, been big into Hearts of Iron 4 recently, which, if anybody wants a very quick bite-sized review, is... very well designed, except for the AI and a little bit of the air system. The AI is going to need a lot of tweaking. However, I've been having a lot of fun playing multiplayer.
Wait. I can give you right now the way you can make that synopsis so they can put it right there on the box. Great game, except for the single player. Richard.
Well, great game, just like every other strategy game, AI still sucks.
Your AI wears pants on its head.
Yes. It really does. You don't understand. There were situations where Germany went to war with France, and France is like, oh, fuck, and abandoned the Maginot Line to go fight Spain for some reason. And people are like, okay, I just walk into France and win. But
given the real-life results, that would have been a better solution for France to actually have gone for.
And they released a beta patch, which results in, when they go to war, the Germans are like, oh, fuck, Poland, and they run all the way over to Poland, and then they go, oh, fuck, France, and the entire army runs all the way over to France, and it's like a weird, like, Benny Hill should be playing, because each front gets closer and closer and closer until the entire army is in Berlin, and then it just falls.
Aren't you making these videos?
Yes.
Like, already? So why don't you have a Benny Hill of these turns and the thing running back and forth until they lose?
This sounds like
it's like money.
It sounds like it'd be fun.
It would. Yeah. I haven't seen that bug personally, unfortunately, but I have heard people have found it. So yeah,
Shriner's Convention of Armies. I like it.
Yeah, and just like Stellaris, it's getting patched and it's getting better. And I'm actually, very, like I said, I'm having a lot of fun in the multiplayer. The co-op capacity of the multiplayer is really cool because we have had basically all of the major countries in our game have co-op set up so that there's two players playing the country. And the way that I've been working Germany with my co-op partner, Simo, I've basically been taking the army and air organization, and he's been working the production, diplomacy, and sort of axis over commander. Like, he's been jumping back and forth between the chat with me talking about research, and then jumping with the rest of the Axis and explaining our plans, like, okay, we're gonna do this in 2 months, are you guys ready? Okay, who needs AT guns? We've got extra AT guns, we can send them to somebody. It's really cool, like all this coordination and stuff that's going on behind the scenes. But it's got 20 people in the game, so as result it kind of crawls. We've had about,
it's like Plan Eve,
8 hours, and that has gotten us to
1940.
Yes, 1940. I think late 1939, early 1940, if I recall correctly.
Okay.
In the most recent game. But yeah, it's a lot of fun. So anyway, the other thing that I've been doing recently is my birthday was just this past last Saturday before. Yes, this. No, 1 week ago today.
Okay.
So,
well, happy birthday.
Thank you. So I got the J. Michael Straczynski, the start of the J. Michael Straczynski run of The Amazing Spider-Man, which is a very popular Spider-Man starting point for new people. And I've always expressed interest in it, and my wife got it for me. And I blew through that thing real quick, and I'm like, I gotta see more, because it's only the first third.
With your white gloves on and all that?
Yeah, it's only the first third of the Spider-Man storyline that he wrote. And so I realized I still had my Marvel Unlimited subscription. And so I started reading that. And then the Marvel people did something that made me angry. And when I get angry, I gotta vent. And when I vent, it's called a Bridger rant. That's right. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm reading through Spider-Man, and it's awesome. I mean, this is some pretty good writing. It's very good. I like it. It's fun. But then I get to this point where they're starting a new storyline, but it says part 3 of 12. And I go back one, and it's not part 1 or 2 of this new storyline. And I go forward one, and I'm like, no, this is 526, and that's 527. There's nothing in the middle. What's going on here? And it takes me a while of Googling before I find out that this storyline was spread across 3 different Spider-Man books that all took place in the same universe. It's not even like this is an Ultimates universe and a regular universe. You have 3 books that all take place in the same universe. Why not just tell all the same stories in the same book? Well, because they have different artists and they have different... So, okay. Part 1 takes place in Friendly Neighborhood Spider-Man. Part 2 is in Marvel Knight Spider-Man. Part 3 is in The Amazing Spider-Man. That's the one I was reading. And then it goes back to Friendly Neighborhood Spider-Man for part 4. Then it goes back to Marvel Knights, etc., etc., all the way through 12. So then I gotta have 3 tabs open and go from one to the other to the other to the other. And as screwed up as this is in print, now I'm online. You could just automatically bring me to the next one in the series and hop from one to the other. This is a solvable problem, people. Instead, it just has me continue in the one series, and it just... I've never wanted to get into comics. Right here.
Nah.
That's the example. It's insane. You never know where to start, and when there's a crossover event, you never know where to go.
But I have a question.
What's
Are
that?
You a Star Wars fan?
Uh-oh. My spider sense is tingling. If I were on the witness stand right now, I'd be like, answering this question is one of those questions which you can't answer right. And what I need to have happen is the Hobgoblin has to bust in and save me from answering this question.
Or do you not like Star Wars?
I like Star Wars.
There you go. They started in part 4 with no goddamn story before any of that. And then you had 2 good films, then 3 terrible ones, and then 3 more that are, well, the one that so far is pretty good.
No, but that's different. That's starting in media res. It's okay because the story is told in a whole complete package. I'm now trying to, because I finished all the other J. Michael Straczynski stories, it rolls right into Civil War, which I've been meaning to read anyway because I kind of wanted to compare it to the movie. But this is 90, I got to pull this up so you guys can see it. This is 90 different issues over the course of like 30 different books. It's insane. This is
why I'm glad that I only ever read the Conan the Barbarian comic books.
So you got, starts with 3 different Spider-Man, which are all in the same series. And then you go to Fantastic Four, these two, and then the new Avengers Illuminati. And then Civil War has its own book. Okay, that makes sense. But then She-Hulk, and then Wolverine has his own Civil War thing. And then we're back to the Amazing Spider-Man, which is a continue. Now there's a Civil War frontline book. And then we go back to the Civil War book. And then who the fuck are the Thunderbolts? And then we got back to the frontline thing. But then X-Factor and new Avengers, which is different from old Avengers, apparently.
Yes.
And... oh, it just goes on and on. So, and then there's Deadpool.
The good news is the Thunderbolts. There's some good news there. The Thunderbolts are actually kids of the Wildcats.
Okay, that brings...
or Thundercats. Thundercats.
Why is this good news?
So it's a tie-in to the Thundercats universe and the Marvel universe. No, I'm completely kidding. Those of you who are actually listening to this now and are slowly having a heart attack, let it go. Let it go.
And then, this is, by the way, this is the only reason I'm reading Civil War is because it gave me this suggested reading order, and I can just click on them to read them. So, I mean, in one respect...
Wait, what website is this?
This is the Marvel.com. This is the official Marvel website. If you pay $10 a month, you get Marvel Unlimited. You can read all of them. And I'm like, I'm doing a fucking advertisement for
them.
Their website
is truly a Marvel.
A Marvel. Well done. Well done. Dad jokes are getting strong, man. You're learning.
I'm physically hurt.
Soon you will rise in dark powers and join me in the ranks here.
So there's 98 of these books coming across all these things. And there's no way I would read this without this like guide. And somebody else has made a guide somewhere, I'm sure. But anyway, let's get back to Star Citizen. I'm veering off topic for far too long. So that's the life in the verse.
I've done nothing with my life is what we're hearing here.
If you want to send us feedback, if you have suggestions on topics and things like that, feedback at Tales of Show. Is that still working? No, that is the new one. Never mind. I'm sorry. Tales of Show is correct. Feedback at Tales of Show.
Keep going.
It still functions.
Don't stop. Don't stop.
So anyway, let's go to the Spectrum Watch. This is the section where we talk about the news that has happened recently. The community got the tutorial taken away.
I'm going to say that the pure level of bugginess in that tutorial got it taken away.
Oh, absolutely.
Like, no amount of alcohol made that thing comprehensible.
Yeah.
There's a thing about it, too. The tutorial had a certain expectation tied to it. I don't know if we talked about this too much yet. That it basically said, this is how your ship will fly. You are learning to fly your ship by doing this. And then the next patch, that didn't work.
Yeah.
You didn't learn how to fly your ship. What you learned was the current set of key bindings after much gnashing of teeth.
Mm-hmm.
That also changed. The tutorial didn't serve any purpose at this point.
Yeah.
If the flight model's not consistent, which it shouldn't be, because they're still working on it. And if the key bindings aren't consistent, which they shouldn't have been because they were working on them, why is there a tutorial? You may as well have just called it the frustration jack-in-a-box. Because what's going to happen is the person's going to hit a button, and it's kind of like playing did it until they end up inside of those two closing doors. One crushes the bottom of their ship, and they explode.
Yeah. And you know what, though?
That's it.
But in the defense of the developers, I think one of the reasons tutorials suck is that they are always, almost always, the last thing to get made, and little consideration is made for them until the very end when there's no time for considering. So you wind up with this thing that's made at the last minute, and it's awful. So one of the best articles I ever read was probably on Gama Sutra that was trying to address the problem of game tutorials being awful. Like, they're either just a giant manual that you read on screen part by part, or the game is doing everything for you, and you're just following along with the instructions and not playing a game anymore.
You can only press here on the map.
I think their idea for the tutorial was actually very good. The way that it's organized and the fact that they started thinking about it early, amazing. I'm glad that we got the feedback out, and nobody seemed to have a problem with the flow. To be fair, it seems like the flow of the tutorial has actually been relatively well received. The problem is it's a buggy piece of shit.
Right, and whenever they changed something, they weren't paying attention to what that change did to the tutorial. And
so, if they can re-enable that in 6 months, they say, okay, well, we have a better idea with Component 2.0 of how ships are going to fly, or at least we know how the Gladius is going to fly. That's all we really need. Then, okay.
Here's what's going to happen. In a week, and this is what led to the tutorial in the first place, in a week, someone's going to post into the Arena Commander or some other area of the forum saying, I don't know how the hell to use my ship. And they will say, well, there was a tutorial, but they got rid of it. It was buggy. And it's going to be the complaint of, why don't they bring back the tutorial?
No,
we need
wrong,
it now. New players, it's inaccessible, which is why they have it in the first
time,
place.
What I've noticed in playing 2.4 is that we have an amazing community. And if you read on the subreddit, you have people who are coming in and thanking people who are playing 2.4. Because if you go into that chat and you're asking, well, how do I do X, Y, or Z, or how do I make my hangar work? Yeah. You have five people chiming in with the right answer. They're not even trolling you. They really want to help.
No, I had that exactly the same thing happen. I was very frustrated because I couldn't for the life of me remember where to find the back button on the Moby Glass. It's so counterintuitive. You have to fix it now. Like, even if it was in the same position at the same, like, almost translucency, so it doesn't look like it's a button, but you made it, like, a back arrow, I would have figured it out. Instead, it's two weird curly buttons that look like they don't mean anything, much less go back.
Yeah.
But anyway, I was trying to remember because I went in the journal and I wanted, journal's not the one I want. I want the scheduler. So I was trying to figure out how do I go back. I close it. I reopen it again. It's still in the journal. But people in the chat help me out.
I found their model for the button, the back button. I'm going to send it to you now, Bridger, so you can just pull that up. This way you can most easily find that back button all the time.
There it is. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's right
in the
secret eye puzzle. No question.
I like that. I like that quite a bit. Now, that said, like Stellaris has a great tutorial that really kind of involves gameplay elements as well as, so if they did something like that, walking through the, hey, the ship's under fire, jump into to your fighter on the carrier, fly out, do your thing, kind of walks you through it without, being on a rail, that would be pretty awesome. Well, I'm not sure that's going to happen, but,
Here was the problem that I had. Every single time I've thought to myself, I should go check out 2.4. The thing that comes up is, you're going to have to reset up all those controls. And you're going to go through the exact same thing. And the thing isn't like, I know that now. But even if I realized, I don't have to do that, I had to do it the first time. And the first time was a nightmare. Because they've tried to completely make this thing super customizable. You've got buttons upon buttons upon buttons that can do tons of things. Buttons that make your shields go down. Buttons that make your shields go up. Buttons that adjust your power in this way or that way, or you're sending more power to engines, shields, whatever. You got buttons that will turn on your landing mode, turn off your landing mode, that will turn on your landing gear, turn off your landing gear, make your landing gear come out automatically. Like, there's just so many. And there's like 27 just for targeting. And it's great, but when three of just them sound identical and I can't remember what the hell each of them does, it's 3 hours of testing before I have my buttons done because I can't remember. Is target focus reticle? Is that the one that targets the thing closest to your reticle? Or is that the one that causes me to like follow them on my screen? Like, oh God, it's just, they need tooltips on that control screen. So when you hover over, it's just a little paragraph saying, this button, when pressed, does this. Like, that's all I need. Oh,
that would be good.
for all that the term quality of life is often overused for things that aren't quality of life but actually buffs, these are actual quality of life changes that will be very nice to have in the user interface.
And you know, I'm not saying, why isn't this in here? This is unacceptable. I demand an answer. This is just me saying, oh, it's so much harder for me to test this as an alpha player when this isn't the case. And I know it's not supposed to be
that
easy.
That voice?
Whatever.
That is now how I'm going to read every concern post. I'm just throwing that out there.
What voice?
Your I demand voice?
Yes, I demand.
I demand.
I demand we exit the European Union as once.
Oh God, no!
Do not engage. So yeah. So one of the things they have so many buttons. This is the first time I noticed this. This may have been in there in the past, but it never just popped. If you go to the screen with the keyboard layout, and I'm squinting at the screen, going, "How am I supposed to read that?" And the second time I booted it up and looked at it, I happened to move my mouse over, and it's got a magnifying glass effect for the keyboard, so you can read the tiny text that's on there. And I'm like, well, that's pretty clever. Now I can read it.
Everyone to take an hour or to take a moment to imagine Bridger squinting at his screen as close in as he can get for an hour, trying to read these tiny buttons.
Too many
buttons.
Never
once thinking, maybe I'll move my mouse over top of this.
If I click on it, what happens?
No, and I went down to the bottom to go to advanced controls so that I could read by scrolling instead of looking at the keyboard. And I finally found out that that's there, and I'm looking, and there's just, like, each button has three different things it does depending upon what mode you're in or whether you're holding down the alt left key or the alt right key. It does something else different. And I'm thinking to myself, so I always knew that Star Citizen was going to have a learning curve, but I never knew it was going to be worse than EVE Online.
Well, it's a flight simulator, so the control scheme is the first learning cliff.
But that's
the right term.
As soon as I saw that, I thought to myself, you know what? They need two different modes. One mode where the entire interface, including that control window where it was showing you what everything does, you cut out at the third of the controls that the vast majority of people are not going to need or want, and you hide them behind a checkbox in the options that makes them available.
That's the tutorial. That's okay. If you want to accelerate, you need to hit Q. If you want to stop, you need to hit S.
Or use the throttle.
When you're looking at the tutorial, they need to basically spell it out. Hey, if you're using a keyboard, hit this button. You know, like in big text at the top of the screen.
That's all well and good, but I'm only going to be able to, as a new player, if like I've never seen this thing before, I'm only going to remember the first 10 or 12 keys you give me in the first hour, and after that, I'm not going to remember.
A tutorial diagram is sort of what you're suggesting at that point.
Well, no, I'm just suggesting we get rid of a lot of it because it's super intimidating. Just get rid of a lot. Not support it, but hide it.
This is the super basic control scheme.
Yes. Okay. You can even not even keep the buttons doing the things that they do. Just don't tell the player that's what they do until they're ready to go deeper. Once they've identified all of the core controls, like only the two things that each button does, leave out the third. not exactly like that, but you get the idea. Take the third of those buttons that are the least likely to be used by new players and hide them, make them go away. And then when people are ready, you can even have a thing pop up 10 hours into their gameplay saying, by the way, now that you feel more comfortable with the basic controls, there's an option in the option screen, the checkbox that allows you to see and access the more advanced controls. Would you like to do so? Like, that would be perfect because it would allow people to have as much customizability as they wanted, and it would not be so intimidating to new players that there's like three different, there's target reticle focus and target focus and reticle focus. What the fuck are those three things do? I'm still stuck up on that.
I'm going to play devil's advocate here. You could just try them.
Yeah, but you understand, when I have to scroll in that controls menu, there are columns,
I understand.
Invisible columns where I can scroll, and there are invisible columns where I cannot scroll. And if I stop scrolling,
the column thing is a little bit interesting.
Yeah, that is a little tricky. I agree with
If I stop scrolling, those columns move. I can't know where they are. It's so frustrating. But yeah, no, I can definitely try them. But that's one example among many. So trying them would take a lot of time and effort. And I had to do that in the past. And I spent a lot of time in Arena Commander doing that. And then a couple months later, I completely forgot what I learned and had to do it again. So anyway, the tutorial is what it is.
It's gone.
It'll get better.
It's gone. It's just gone.
It's alpha.
It is what
alpha is.
It's gone.
Yes. New ship updates.
It'll be back.
This player-made map, I was just looking at this today, Gray. This is amazing. I'm going to pop it up
on
the screen here.
Yeah. Yes,
the link is in the show notes. I was looking at that, and man, that is super well done.
It is a beautiful, a beautiful ship.
And it, the fact that someone took the time to really go through the video and say, here's exactly what we've seen. Here's the content we've got. That's great. That's,
yes.
And I'm sure some of this is subject to change, but still, looks like the Caterpillar is getting real close to hangar ready.
And it looks like the kind of place that I could... It looks like it's got the kind of character that the Firefly class ship has, right? You got the lower engineering bay, the upper engineering. There's enough space in there.
Now. Oh, no.
You got enough space in there. I feel like I could live on this ship.
The mystery room. I mean, let's be clear on this. The mystery room.
Where's the mystery room?
Well, it's right there under the bridge.
So it is.
I mean, you wouldn't want to call it just cargo access or something like that. No, this is the mystery room.
Yeah.
Huh.
I mean, it's above the mystery habitation. Room is kind of where it starts attaching the modules. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, it does make sense that that's the EVA room or something like that. But
I love the name. I thought it was great. Then heavy engine, heavy fuel tank, as opposed to the light engines and light fuel tanks.
Well, they have said actually that the engines in the Caterpillar class are going to be
heavy.
A little bit, bigger, a little bit big. So
no, it's a cargo question. Like I said, I love this map. Kudos to the guy that did it. This was actually taken from a Reddit post.
Do we have his name off top?
I can go find it, and I will go find it
because I'm properly this in the first properly place. Credit
yeah,
this fellow,
properly credit that was... this. Yeah, yeah. I was chasing my 8-month old while I was trying to link this stuff into chat. It was very entertaining for him and for me. Because he has started to crawl today in earnest, which is a good way to find out what you have and have not baby proofed in your house is
it's a quick learning curve, isn't
when it? When your 8-month old starts crawling and finds all the things you didn't quite seal up well enough for him to get access to.
Yeah, just
here it is. Looks like altered perceptions.
Yep, that would be the one.
So altered perceptions wherever you are. Well done.
Well done.
Very well done.
And here is the update that they posted about the Caterpillar. I mean, the last thing that I remember seeing was the gray box from a long time ago. This looks almost... I mean, all this stuff looks gorgeous. This looks almost photorealistic sometimes when you're looking at it up close. It's crazy good. And I noticed that today. I was walking around the PU, the baby PU, Port Olisar, and I just stopped for a second and just started looking around the room I was in without moving, and damn, it looks really freaking good. It looks like the videos, but when I'm walking around, it feels so laggy and goofy that I'm just like, oh, it's crap. But when I stop and look around, it's great.
You're not really running a potato. You're running on more of like a yam.
It's a little higher. Yeah, but my yam cost me like $1,000. This is an
i7.
It's a 970. This is not
micronutrient and macronutrient wise are identical. Don't start with that. It's like saying white rice and brown rice. Brown rice is better. No, go fuck yourselves.
Oh my God.
They're the same.
How do you
They're
really
so close, it doesn't matter.
All right, so anyway, that's the Caterpillar. Caterpillar's looking good. The Drake Dragonfly was revealed and sort of shown off recently, and that's where we get the construction yellow is in comment from the beginning.
I believe you mean the Star Wars ground speeder.
Color?
It's kind of like a swoop.
Yeah.
It's going on kind of the swoop appeal.
Pod racing! We can pod race, finally!
Yellow is the new
Did you see that part of the hatching the Drake Dragonfly thing was... or in the little manual, because they got the whole brochure this time through, has ground races. It looks like pod racing.
I didn't see anything about pod racing in there. Where can I become an alien who, like, camouflages the other racers?
Camouflages the other racers?
Damn it, sabotages. Camouflage, sabotage, same damn thing.
What? Like with spray painting them with military camo.
There you go. Show up. I like that.
You heard it here first, folks. Camouflaging the other racers.
So this
If I can't see them, I can only win.
Aside from the Starfarer, this is one of the first ones we've seen with like a brand new role. The Starfarer going into flight ready status is the most recent thing that I could think of. I mean, we've still got the big mining vessels and things like that, but this is the first one that we've seen as a concept ship recently. That's a brand new role that we've never seen before, right? So
it's pretty nice. It's good to see that they decided to buckle down and say let's make a ship a snub. That has sort of a ground role.
The Amateur Open Canopy Racing League.
Yeah, you've got that, and then later on you've got the Hyperion Rally, which is like a ground race, I guess. These are really cool little ships. And yes. The fact that they set it up specifically to be focused on this dual role and this dual ability to, you know, put this in your bay and say, when I'm out and I need to go check a flashing distress beacon, I can ride this thing. Or if I'm going down to a planet, I can ride this thing. That's a pretty nice duality to it.
So there's
Go ahead. There were some interesting questions about both riding on planets and riding in space involving EDA suits and resources. And this is one of the first times in recent memory that this has been addressed. It looks like we're actually going to be dealing with suit resources sooner rather than later. Oxygen running out kind of thing.
Now,
don't we have infinite oxygen?
We won't. That'll be fun.
What about maneuvering gas? Because the way that the EVA suits move around is they release a little bit of gas in one direction or another. That seems like that's a fuel that's going to have to be...
But it sounds like that fuel may be something that has to be recharged. They're talking about needing to recharge fuel on the Dragonfly in one of the communities.
Mm. Like that's your oxygen. Like you're venting your oxygen to move around. That's a very poor way of doing it.
And it's not like the Dragonfly has, you know, quantum fuel or anything. They're saying the Dragonfly will have a range.
Huh.
So you're going to have your little gas meter that you're going to have to watch while you're flying around in that thing.
Although, Bridger, for reference, it wouldn't be oxygen. If you're looking for reaction mass, water is a lot better for that. You superheat it because let's say we have fusion engines on these things. You superheat it to vent and then you just fly. But interesting. So we've got that makes me wonder if the rovers will end up being better for ground exploration.
Do you mean the ones with actual wheels?
Yeah, because they'll be slower. I mean, almost as a given. But if they actually have range, you know, whereas the Dragonfly can only go out a little ways and come back. Or even better, if I can land my Dragonfly on a rover and then just rover out and then do sorties on the Dragonfly.
The other thing it reminds me of is the Firefly, like in the Firefly movie in Serenity, they had that sort of hovering thing that they fought with the like the first opening scene where they're doing the robbery and the whatchamacallums come down. And he's like, gee, it would be great if we had grenades right about now. They're flying in like a hover, you know, thing that kind of reminded me of the Dragonfly in its sort of role as well. Go ahead.
It's like the hover cart and buggy, right?
Yeah, exactly. Or like a like a rideable pallet jack. If you've ever worked in a warehouse, it's like a rideable pallet jack type thing that hovers instead.
The mule
that's
reference.
What it is. The
Magic
mule.
Zipper
thank you. I haven't
mule.
Seen.
Yes.
I need to go. Cool. Like I need to go with like my seventh rewatch of that series plus movie because I'm clearly forgetting.
I prefer
details.
The hover cart and buggy because let's just go that far.
Okay.
All right.
Fine.
But yeah, it. So I mean, as far as the ground game goes, to make this a little jujitsu-ish, it's. I'm interested to see why you'd want a rover versus a Dragonfly, other than the fact that, like, you know, the Constellation does not have an option for a Dragonfly right now. They just have the rovers. But, I mean, other than that, it looks like a fun little ship that I would love to ride and then be shot at.
When you're looking at the rovers and, like, the Constellation and that kind of thing, I'm under the impression that they're going to serve a bigger role. Like, you look at the size of the Ursa.
Yeah.
I mean, for one, it's got a turret on it, which tells me first and foremost, you probably don't want to screw with the thing once they get turret mechanics going.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. One of these days.
But, yeah, there's like K-Bomb is saying in here is driving things off a cliff. Mm-hmm. I think a Dragonfly may survive that.
You mean it should be able to slow itself when it got close to the ground fast enough?
Yeah. You may not have a lot of luck with that with an Ursa. Well, but the Ursa may be able to get a whole lot more cargo out.
Here's the question.
A whole lot more...
What physics-based system is it using to hover over the ground that it can't use to hover 30 feet above the ground?
My guess would be this is where range comes in. You may very well be able to turn the Dragonfly into space
like a helicopter
or whatever
or
you want to try to call it. In atmosphere for a very short period of time, but the amount of fuel you'd have to blow through would be just astronomical. The difference may be that in ground mode, it's basically pointing maneuvering thrusters downward and using those to push up.
Yeah.
So
do you need ground in order to I mean, thrust is an increase
no,
just because you have ground there.
But you're saying you've seen some of the bigger airplanes, like those big Soviet things that flew right over top of water. They only went a few meters over the ground because you're using that effect.
I can actually describe this. It's called the ground effect, literally.
The ground effect.
And it's when you've got thrust that pushes down. Boeing actually had a concept for this called the Pelican. God, I'm really going into Cold War era shit, aren't I? Anyway,
it's fun,
The Pelican was flying at like 14 feet above sea level. And then it had auto guidance. The concept was that auto guidance, where if it saw a swell or a wave, it would begin to go up and then let the lift just push it up that wave. And it would literally be doing this while it flies over the ocean moving cargo, using the ground effect to basically cut fuel use in half, which was pretty cool.
Okay, yeah. I'll buy it.
If the Dragonfly is going to have a fuel range, that would probably be the whole thing. Okay, so your fuel is keeping you suspended off the ground in that thing. Yes. And maybe the Ursa doesn't have as big of a range thing. Maybe the Ursa actually has like a nuclear reactor sitting in the back of this big ass thing.
Yeah, if you don't have to use any of your energy to hover above the ground, if your wheels take care of that part, then maybe it's not that big a deal.
But to make it futuristic, I'm going to say it has an anti-grav engine, and the anti-grav works better the higher the gravity is. It gets more repulsion effect.
Yes. Yeah. And we've got, you know, for the first time, I haven't seen this basically in forever, but we've got some skeptics in the chat. Ant-Man is skeptical that the game will ever come out.
Well, he also used the word scam. So,
yeah.
You know,
but we don't usually get that in the chat, is what I'm saying.
Derek, man, I appreciate it, but.
In one of his many guises.
He has a video. Hey guys, he has a video.
Well, okay. To be fair, so do a lot of people. I mean, I have videos, and
anyway,
no one in their right mind listens to me.
It's one question he posed, which is worth addressing, is Ant-Man said, if we can't even trust regular early access games with small goals, how the heck do we expect this massive game to be developed?
Okay.
Go ahead.
What do you mean by early access? Just not to go too far down this whole awful rabbit trail.
Yeah.
But the idea of what you call a regular early access game?
The ones that fail all the time, I would guess.
Are we talking about an indie game? Are we saying you can't trust an indie game with whatever that budget happens to be on Steam Early Access to create a game? Are you asking these folks, you know, there was an article that came out on, I think it was r/all, just talking about these game developers who were living in their parents' home. It wasn't a bad thing.
I have my own house, goddammit.
But they didn't have enough money to even pay their own rent while they're trying to develop this game. And it was a really thankless job for them. And you ask why some of those smaller titles fail or why some of these smaller titles have problems. I mean, there's a million resources for you to check out why that's the case. Now, you start asking, well, why can we trust Star Citizen when these smaller titles have these problems? Well, the answer to that question is about 115 million different answers. On top of the fact that we do have someone who has a proven record of making
games. Right, I was going to say experience is a very important piece of this. Yeah,
if you want to crap all over Chris Roberts for making... four Wing Commander games, Freelancer, Privateer.
Yeah, but only two of those, maybe three of those, were really good. I mean, the rest.
They're just okay. Say what you want to about him,
and I do.
That he made a pile of blockbuster titles.
That asshole.
But he did it. And when you start talking about why do we trust him in a crowdfunded situation. It's pretty straightforward. He has a record of actually making really good games. And if you're freaked out about the budget...
Ant-Man's response is coming through.
This is bullshit.
No, I kid.
If you're freaked out about the time frame, if you're freaked out about the fact that this is a AAA title, if you're freaked out about the fact that this is, in fact, $115 million, freak out. Okay. But if you're going to look at it and say, this just can't happen... You're not following development. What you're doing is you're just saying, I don't believe that anybody can do anything with a scale. And I think that you're probably full of shit. we're trying to do something here. We're trying to fund something here that has no publisher, that has a studio of experienced people behind it making it, that is giving us actually really good updates compared to anything else you'd ever actually see made, aside from perhaps Descent Underground, which is now on, what, a one sprint newsletter, which, by the way, good on Wingman for that. I think we have a lot to be optimistic about with this title. And people who are claiming that they're trying to scam by doing concepts, by doing these offerings, may say all you want, but in all honesty, they are not scamming people.
No, and the proof is in the pudding. We can play 2.4. Yeah. It's not perfect, but there have been updates upon updates upon updates. We see the fruits of their labor. It's a scam if we had just gotten promise after promise after promise with no result. We can see the results, but I think I would guess that the response to that by skeptics, I guess, I hate to use that term because it isn't really what that is supposed to mean.
It's naysayers.
Small s, not big s. But
naysayers.
Okay, sure. But I mean, but people who are skeptical of it, and there's it's entirely reasonable position for some of the reasons that he's saying. If you don't know who the developers are, if you don't have trust in them, then, or you might just think that no game this ambitious has ever been created before, so why should we assume that this one's going to work? And the answer to that is, you don't have to assume it's going to work, but you can still be hopeful for it. Even if there's a 40% chance that this is going to work, it's worth throwing a little bit of my money at it. $40 for the chance that something this ambitious can work, I'm okay with that.
And for those who can throw more because they want to support the title, go for it.
Yeah, because if you throw 15,000 at it, then you're increasing that percentage to like 40.2215.
15,000? What's wrong with you?
I was just taking the largest
package. It's a video game. God damn it.
The largest.
Come on.
I haven't done that.
Perspective.
I know.
So, I mean, limit yourself to like a grand like Gray here. I mean, come on.
I see the setup now. I see how that works. Wow. Okay. Dragging us back on track. Somebody hit, I think it was
this
me.
This brings us actually back really nicely to the roadmap.
Okay.
I'm jiggy with it. Go ahead.
We can get back to 2.4 and the play experience in a little bit. This does actually bring us nicely to the roadmap. We did find out from Chris Roberts and 10 for the Chairman, as well as listening from Around the Verse, we have some ideas now for 2.5, 2.6, and 2.7, which are the main three big patches to come. 2.5, apparently it looks like we're getting our pirate space station. Mm-hmm. This is not a direct copy of Port Olisar. It's some new model. It's some new setup for the sake of making it so that when you spawn with criminal status, you don't immediately get killed by 10 Avengers breathing down your throat, which is hilarious to watch, for the record.
Now, each time you die, does that lower your criminal record so the next time you die a little slower, or
it's persistent now, baby.
Yeah, and actually I think this is one of the reasons that they actually aren't providing a monetary loss per death right now. It's been reported up and down on the issue council that you're not losing money every time you die. Honestly, as long as when you're a criminal and you spawn they immediately blow your ship up or try to, losing money on death probably doesn't make sense quite yet. That said, if they're doing this pirate station in 2.5, that sounds like they're also going to be adding more space and more content. They're going to be expanding what we're going to see, because I can't see them slamming a pirate station into the current ecosystem, so to speak. It needs a little more room.
Olisar versus
work.
Pirate base. Go. Like, that would be a really interesting thing.
The Port Olisar pirate base divide there just far enough where you can't shoot when you spawn is the ideal way to test this out.
Just turn it into a tribes game, why don't you? Oh, where should we put our base? Right next to the people
we hate. Yeah, exactly. It's the ideal spot. How better to pirate?
That is the entire plot for PlanetSide 2.
Yeah.
Where should we put our base? Right next to the people we hate.
Yes.
God, yeah.
So that's the other thing is the exact. So when they said, okay, these guys are pirates, What they meant was they are pirates, so they copied the plans. Like, you wouldn't download a car. Yeah, but we'll download the plans for your base and make an identical symmetrical version directly across the way.
I would absolutely download a goddamn car.
Yeah, let's put that to rest.
3D printers exist for this reason, to let me pirate the Tesla. I can't afford that 3D printer. No one can. But the point is, if I could, I would.
Okay, so anyway.
There has been some notes from folks in chat. We have been confirmed that at some point in the next few patches, Nyx is going to get ported in. Not as its own system, but the Nyx planet, like the one that we saw the landing zone for, will at some point make its way into Crusader.
Right, so you'll be able to warp to it.
They're going to temporarily have it be a part of the Crusader system that you can quantum drive to and from. Maybe that's the pirate base. We don't know. If it is, that would be pretty cool. And it would actually mean that they have a whole bunch more asteroid fields and all that kind of thing. But yeah.
Yeah, so they're going to put a bunch of stuff in the Stanton system that's not going to be in the Stanton system eventually. And then once they have enough stuff there, then they can spread them out to their own systems and make them, you know, then we'll get the child PU and eventually the adolescent PU. We don't want to play that one.
The prepubescent
PU is probably not very good. Yeah, so guys, he said PU.
I'm a little uncomfortable with this topic. I mean, anytime three grown men discuss children, someone's going to complain to the FBI.
You're right. We're on a list somewhere.
Well, of course I have to go there.
And you said FBI. That guarantees that they're listening. So yeah, we got the netcode enhancements. I'm very, very excited about that. And then procedural planets in 2.7. That's insane.
Yeah.
I didn't think we'd see those until after the game came out, much less now.
It sounds like 2.6 is that basis to allow 2.7 to happen, because if they expand to the whole like multi-planet system now with the bad netcode, you've got a problem. But yeah, 2.7 procedural planets. They've talked about procedural cities.
No, jeez, so, that'd be crazy.
That's how they're talking about doing like ArcCorp. Just procedural city generation all around the planet.
You know what? You could do that with a corp, because a corporation would do everything in the most efficient way possible. So every storefront would be the exact same dimensions, every store would be a chain.
Company towns, 2,200.
Exactly.
At the same time, they don't have to make it so you can approach the entire planet still. But they could then say low level of detail, procedurally generate every building on the entire planet, and still have your custom-built landing zones.
Which does make it a little different than some of the other products that are out there doing procedural. Like, you've got
No Man's Sky.
No Man's Sky. Then there's another one, and I actually have played Elite, that has the whole procedural worlds as well, but it's kind of a fixed universe, so it's interesting.
Yeah.
So this is, you know, we're going to procedurally generate small areas, but that is a huge step forward from the original roadmap. I mean, they were saying they might have like a patch or an expansion that had DLC or had procedural planets.
I think there was a realization when they got into making the planets and they got into making content that they would have
a lot of it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But there was a realization that they'd have to make a lot of planets for a lot of systems that had no cities.
Yeah.
That had no no settlements at all, that were just, you know, a ball of rock.
Basically landmarks in space.
Then they made some of the moons for 2.4, and I think that was a lot of effort. And they realized, well, if we can get Frankfurt to crank out some procedural generation, and the guys there seemed pretty into it when they talked about it on all the shows.
If you don't have to worry about human-made objects that have to look like humans would have placed them and designed them there, you can do tons of great procedural generation. No Man's Sky proves that.
Look at Elite Dangerous, even.
Yeah.
Their rocky moons are really well done.
They are. They are. And the asteroids as well. I mean, you'd actually go into detail on those things. And for a hunk of rock, it's actually really interesting.
Do not knock what they've done with that game. They have made some really incredible procedurally generated content with those moons and little rocky planets. I think that we're going to be in for a lot of that with Star Citizen. And there was a realization that they could quickly crank it out.
And it makes sense from a content generation point of view, because like you said, if they spend, you know, 120 hours of an artist's time making a planet, and then they realize we could have made 40 of these in this time with the right tool. And of course, they'll make 40 of these in this time with the right tool.
That artist is much more valuable if they're making a temperate planet. Right, that's very detailed and very difficult to make.
The trees and everything are going to be very difficult for them.
And you'd probably
have
to put some settlements on there, or alien settlements, or whatever. Those are probably going to have to be handcrafted in order to look right. Or you make a procedural base, and then they'll stick these things into it. But for all the rocky moons and asteroids and like lava planets and whatever you want to make, that's like pretty inhospitable, where maybe you have one human station on there that an artist would have to go in and do. You're right. The procedural stuff makes a ton of sense to make that whole process faster. And we kind of skipped over a section. I wanted to talk about 2.4 before we jumped into the roadmap, but...
Oh, we're past that.
We can go back to that now.
We were playing a little bit of the 2.4. I played it a little bit yesterday and today. I was talking about the whole control thing earlier, but one of the other things, there were some improvements that I did notice in that the alt-tabbing is smooth and fast and no problems. It doesn't hiccup. You can alt-tab out of a loading screen and it doesn't break the game anymore. So basic quality of
the
life things like that. A lot of improvements to the client. A lot of improvements. Loading times much faster. Yeah. Very happy with those.
There is a problem... for people who are stuck with infinite load right now. Mm-hmm. I would that note that I was one of those people for a time.
Okay.
The problem is that Windows base filtering engine is having trouble assigning IPs and handling packets from Cloud Imperium's client right now.
Interesting.
And what you have to do in order to fix this is turn off all of the Windows firewall, turn off all of Windows Defender, and then right-click and restart base filtering engine. And once
you make
restarted
it relearn
that,
the rules.
Yep. Once you've restarted base filtering engine, then you can re-enable all your firewall, re-enable everything else. You know, hopefully this only takes a few seconds.
But we here at Tales of Citizen in no way advocate turning off network security features to make this happen.
Only do it when you've actually physically pulled the cable. When you physically pulled the cable out of your computer, that's when that's okay.
Yes, that's true.
That's how you do that.
Yes, and I'm posting the links right now into both YouTube and Twitch chat just for folks who are interested. If you've been stuck with infinite load, there is a fix out there. Okay. You can play. Your client isn't screwed, and you don't need to reinstall.
Which
just
is
know
awesome.
That it's there. Yeah, it's a much quicker thing than you might have thought. And as long as you have admin access on your computer, you can do it.
So,
well, I mean, I wouldn't trust our users with admin to their own computers, so I don't see why they would. But if you did, you could give it a shot.
Yeah.
So the other thing that I noticed while playing through 2.4 is the missions and the system that they've set up really does feel the way that I expected it to feel. Things flow from one thing into another. It doesn't feel gamey, like something just shows up and it gives you a big arrow and says, go over here and talk to George. You show up and the dialogue that the person, you know, you go up to one of those, ICC stations or whatever that they're asking you to go on a mission. Like you show up and their dialogue sounds fairly natural. It doesn't sound super exposition heavy. So I got this... very brief, but very real feeling like this is what the game is going to be like, and it's feeling pretty awesome. Like, but that was between things where I'm like, fuck, what does this button do? And and times when I was like, oh crap, I can't strafe yet, I'm crashing, and I'm dead.
Yeah.
I'm flying around in my glaive watching Bridger ram his 325 into another 325 over and over and over again.
That wasn't my fault. The game lagged for half a second, and then he was
it
in
was
front of
me.
It was pretty much your fault.
The tree jumped right out in front of me.
Which again is another reason why we, as users and backers, trust that the product's gonna get built. We can see it being built in front of our eyes,
and it's getting better.
But carry on. So we covered the roadmap. We covered 2.4. We have covered 2.7, 2.6, and 2.5. The possibility of the next station. But really, I'm concerned.
It's time to move on to the concern of the week, where
I am concerned. Before
the concern of the week, I did want to note something to our users about 2.4. This confused the crap out of me. If you're an FPS player, there are guns that you can pick up in the wrecks. It's little green lights that are floating around. Okay. So you can float out of your ship and go pick up weapons, like shotguns, sniper rifles, you name it. If you log out, or if you die, those guns will disappear. They are not persistent to you.
Oh.
Hmm.
If you buy a gun with AUEC from the stores,
persistence,
like in Olisar, not only are they persistent, if you die, you keep the gun.
Huh.
Very nice.
There is no way for you to lose your guns currently if you buy them with AUEC. So if you're worried about, like, oh, that shotgun looks cool, but I'm going to get blown up 6 times today, don't worry about it. Get the shotgun. You're fine.
Hold up.
You have LTI on your shotgun.
Don't worry about it. No. I just heard at the beginning of this show, some asshole was standing there as a security guard and double-tapping poor bastards in the back of the head.
That's right, I was. Because you know what? They paid me to do that. I got 250 credits for double-tapping that guy, and then 2,500 more because he didn't successfully use the computer.
Yes. Somebody just wanting to check their email, and you're sitting there go, nope! Goodbye.
Yep.
So...
Yep. Checking his pirate email.
Right pirate, yeah, on P-mail.
So you mean P-mail, yeah.
Note to users, do not look for P-mail.
No.
It's not just golden showers anymore.
Oh. yeah.
Yeah,
okay.
That just happened.
You're welcome.
And there
You're
goes welcome. The mature tag.
Yeah.
So anyway.
I have said nothing that's immature. All right.
You know what? This episode is going to be entitled, So Anyway.
But on to concerns.
Concerns. We do like to have a section of the show where we talk about concerns that have shown up on the forums, because for a while it was a joke how terrible most of these concerns are and how easy to answer they are. But there are also real concerns, and I have found some in the concern thread. Like, you know what? Right now, and we got one that Callie's picked up here, but I want to point this out. I don't know if we covered this one way back when we were doing shows. The big Voyager Direct store melting concern. That's a year and a half later there, edition.
Right? Yeah. You know, this is a really interesting thing. Because
this is
I actually
a legitimate
expected
concern.
That they would, I expected they'd do the melt.
I did too. They said they were going to.
But then somebody decided they didn't. I mean... It's pretty clear they didn't want to have to flag weapons as to whether they've been melted yet or not, because the last thing they want is someone to say, okay, I'm going to get 10,000 UEC, and I'm going to turn it into every possible weapon in that range,
and then
depending
on
what I want
it.
To test, and then unmelt it and melt it and melt, you know, so on and so forth. It seems like the potential for abuse is really high, and I'll be honest, I didn't think about that. That was a design decision that I missed. I didn't see the potential to abuse it quite so heavily.
Well, that's because you're reasonable.
Yeah.
There is a great potential to abuse these things if you think about it in the sociopathic view.
You must
think like a software engineer. I need to be thinking this way.
Yeah, see, but when you get to software management and you're managing engineers, and that's where I'm at right now, then you can think about it this way. Can you think, how will my engineers try to fuck me? And once you have that viewpoint, it's all very easy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I sympathize with these folks. I really do. Because the idea of being able to say, oh, yeah, you know, this, what is it, the frickin' the close range, the neutron guns.
Oh, okay.
At one point, I picked up a neutron gun, and there's a part of me that's like, you know, I wouldn't mind melting that out, getting something else. And then I have the realization, wait a second, I'm part of the problem. I would abuse the crap out of this system if things didn't line up quite the way that I wanted them to. And I kind of appreciate the fact that they're looking at it now and they're saying, we really don't want people to buy a lot from this system and think, oh, I can just do whatever I want with these credits anyway.
Well, and I can pay to win.
Yeah, yeah. I kind of like the idea that they're saying, well, this is more permanent. And I know that this really sucks for a lot of folks. And yeah, I'm affected. You know, I would probably melt that neutron gun.
But right now, I think because there was so much talk about it happening for so long, and people may regret, you know, having bought something ahead of time. And now that we've got the ability to, like, rent stuff with the REC and stuff, I think they should just take all the stuff bought in the Voyager store and just melt it one time. Just give everybody one time freebie. And I mean, make that happen either now or at the beta point or at the point where you just get all the stuff that you bought back for whatever you paid for it. And everybody starts fresh one time. That way you don't have to go, and that solves a lot of the problems. And they might do that in the future. Who knows?
The problem is if they warn people that they're going to do this, how many people would then load up on random crap weapons? So would be able to break the UEC cap.
Yeah.
Oh, you're saying that the cap is the problem. Okay.
Yeah, they didn't want people to game the UEC cap because thought was if they let people melt, what they would end up doing is they'd say, well, my cap is 150,000. I'm going to buy 2 million worth of badgers. And then I'm going to immediately melt every one of these badgers. And maybe they could say, well, you can only melt until you hit the cap. But then there's the problem of what if people want to be sitting at the cap? Do you say, well, you can expand the cap by one weapon melt every time?
Yeah. There's a lot of things. That's why I think before we go into the main thing, just one time melt without telling anybody, because that can't possibly hurt anybody. Unless they have so many things to rebuy that it literally takes them an hour to rebuy everything. But I don't think anybody's going to be in that thing. Everybody's using REC now. Nobody's spending their actual UEC. Everybody's got a UEC or they've got REC at this point. And that's honestly,
there's a lot of wreck out
that's
there.
Honestly what should have been the first thing that people used permanently is REC and a UEC.
They should have come up with rec a lot faster.
It was a mistake. That's why I think that's what they should do right now is make the Voyager Direct stuff. Yeah. Just boom, give everything back. But then nothing you can buy in that store now matters. Everything is the AUEC and the REC until we go into the actual game.
But experience is a harsh teacher. And you know, this is not a problem or not an issue that...
This isn't an easy fix.
No, you're
right. So the next version of a lot of these games where they have an early access phase like this, and I suspect the next batch of or next gen of early access games are going to have rental credit equivalents. You know, Ark 2, Adventures in the Ice Age, or whatever it's going to be, they're going to say we're going to do a full server wipe from the beginning. So no one believes that they're not going to do it. They just had I mentioned that because they had a huge issue with that last week. And on top of that, because they one developer said this is. Arc drama. One developer said that they were going to wipe the whole thing, and the community complained, to which they said, okay, we won't do a wipe. So now it's the let the users have their way on the official servers kind of thing. But back to the point. So they will say, we're going to do a wipe. You are going to start from scratch at some point on the official servers, because that is when we go to actually release a game, we don't want you to have superpowered characters killing the newbies for fun and profit.
Right.
So that kills the experience for most of us. So we want you to not do that, but we can't ask you to, so we're going to force you to. And on top of that, everything you bought will have this rental credit instead of the actual money. But you who backed us will have all of the early backing, bonuses that you wanted.
Yeah.
Yeah, and there's people in the chat saying, and this is going to be a giant issue too, it's a huge pain in the ass, but they said they need to allow REC-bought ships to go into the universe, and I say no to that. Like, even if I had, every ship possible in the because I got a bunch of REC and bought it, that's the whole point of starting fresh.
Yeah.
I mean, rec gets cleared, and they're very clear that rec is going to get cleared at random patches. Right. That's great. The UEC, I don't know what they should do, honestly. I'm not convinced that they should melt. I almost feel like they should say, tough luck. When you bought it, there was no guarantee you could melt.
I mean, you're going to be able to... Yeah. So here's the question. The stuff that you bought on the Voyager Direct, you're going to have that in the game when you first start it. Can you sell it on the market at that point and get back the vast majority of whatever you paid for it? If so, then there's no problem. People can melt it once they get in game. Right?
They've said it's not soulbound. You're going to be able to
soulbound. Just imagine a guy. I'd like to sell my 325, and the guy comes up to it with a mystic scanner. Nope. Nobody else is going to be able to fly this except for you.
It's not mystic. Yeah. The controls on this one are coded to your DNA. I can't help that. You've got the safe flight control.
Yeah, remember that small print that you signed? No resale due to DNA matching? Yeah, that's
you can't correct. You can't pull the trigger unless the fingers match the right DNA, and it only stings a little bit every time you put your finger on it.
Of course. Yeah, just grabs a little tiny patch of skin. There was one other concern.
As it's been noted, the UEC store technically is all LTI, so those weapons will actually be insured. What that means for a missile, we don't yet know, but that'll be interesting to see.
If you lose your missile, you go back to the insurance.
I mean,
yes, my missiles were in an accident where they exploded on one of my enemies.
maybe if your ship log shows that you never fired it, you get the missile back. So your ship gets blown up with 10 missiles, you get all 10 back. But if you launch one, you now have 9, and you only get 9 back. I don't know. I just don't know. But in that case, we're firing pennies at people once the thing comes out live.
But now you're straight out of wargaming, and we're in real trouble.
Yeah. All right. Off of that topic. Anyway,
so there was one other concern that I know was bothering Calathulu this week. Why don't you describe us that?
Well, I mean, okay, I'm going to caveat this ahead of time so that no one gets too upset, but it was actually the best Reddit discussion I have seen among people of differing viewpoints, in that there was no flaming or anger. Which means that it was done at some point when most of us weren't awake.
Yes.
But
the Australians had a conversation and they kept it civil.
I said no flaming in anger. The Australians don't qualify.
Okay.
I have talked to Tim. I know Australians.
Okay.
All right. Now, so the concern of the week, subscriber cancellations en masse. Fair warning, en masse may be a bit overstated. But basically, it's I just canceled my subscription. Hi, citizens. I'm a longtime backer ever since November 2013 and a subscriber since February 2015 and almost 800 euros. That's a weird symbol in the game. But today I canceled my subscription. I have a feeling the game is on a good track, and based on Sean Tracy's reaction regarding PG and based on what last summer's leaks have shown, I'm pretty sure we don't even see the tip of the iceberg. And this is exactly my concern. We don't even see the tip of the iceberg.
Just the tip.
Just the tip. I have difficulty to understand why SIG draws the line where it is drawn now between showing stuff and hitting stuff. Hitting is intentionally spelled that way. I have been a subscriber for almost a year and a half, and yet the best jump point I've ever had a chance to read was the very first one.
He then goes on to explain how he really likes to learn about the design of planets and he hates learning about the design of ships.
Yeah.
And so this, he has a agenda, which is I love planets and I hate spaceships and I wish we could fly planets, which don't we all? But
we're being a little bit hyperbolous.
We are because we enjoy the concern of the week is where sarcasm has come to live.
It's where sarcasm comes to die also.
No, well, kind of. I mean, it's the circle of life. It's the Ouroboros, right?
Sure.
But let us go hyperbolic on it. Basically, the same as I'm canceling my subscription, and so should you.
Is that what you said at
bastards.
The end?
You bastards. No, not at all.
Not really, no.
But that's how everyone took it. That's why I said en masse, and then en masse is an exaggeration. But basically, the real concern here is, you know, what a subscriber's getting, and does it really, you know, is ATV, which is relatively
And what are they
light.
Funding? It's
yeah,
not just
what are
they,
what
are they getting? Because
fair.
You can argue about what you're getting, and they're getting jump point produced.
Well, jump point, ATV,
and
for the chairman.
No. What they're getting is jump point, flare, and then the catalogs and stuff.
Okay.
Personally getting, right. What they're funding is ATV, 10 for the blank,
chairman.
10 for the X.
Okay, 10 for the blank,
And then
jump point.
Yes, so those things.
Is it worth your $20 or $10 a month or $204 if you buy it ahead of time? So the short answer is it is never worth it. If you're buying this because you want it to give you back an equivalent value, it's an investment, stop yourself. Don't click that button. Go buy a share of T-Mobile. Don't actually take my advice here, okay? Let's be clear.
Not a financial advisor.
Yeah.
Don't do that.
Yeah. Or go buy the pound sterling. Making this part of the Brexit joke again.
You could do that now.
Yeah, you could totally do it now. It might get worse, but it's probably going to get better. So here's the thing. This is my interpretation of this whole thing. He talks about how it's been mostly fluff recently, and there hasn't been as much meat and potatoes as you might find. That's the first thing. And to be honest, I think that's true as well. And here's the problem. You can't scale the interest of game design, how interesting it is, with more money. So lots of people subscribing won't make the content of ATV better. It won't make the content of Jump Point better once you reach a certain threshold. If you get to a threshold where you can pay somebody full time to make Jump Point look really good, make it formatted well, and make sure that they're interviewing the people right. Yeah, I'm just saying there's a threshold where throwing more money to make that more interesting doesn't happen because its interest is related to whatever interest you have in the game design they're doing right now. Once you throw enough money at making ATV that you've got a bunch of people doing it full time and you've got a nice set and you've got people spending their time creating the different segments, you can't make it better by throwing more money at it. But that's, you know, what winds up happening. Who knows how much subscriber money they have left over after, because they haven't built a new set in a while, but they are still paying, you know, Sandy and Ben to do that and the other people that are involved with those sort of community related projects. So it doesn't scale is what I'm trying to say. And the interestingness of those pieces is directly related to how interesting things they have to talk about that week.
And Richard and I were having a discussion earlier about the content at ATV specifically and the segments. When you break it down, there's a few segments of it. There's a general news section where Sandy and Ben sit down and they talk you through whatever's coming. And that's exactly what Breeder's talking about right now. They just want to say, here's the exact thing that we're doing. Here's what we're expecting. Here's the next convention, whatever else. That leads into the office reports. So why do we have the office reports?
Yeah.
It's because people were really interested office by office in what was going on and asked for them.
A few people.
At a time when they were missing release dates for Arena Commander, which is how long ago now? 18 months?
It's been a while.
Yeah. So this was a reaction to more the whole community. Yeah, more than that. But the whole community or the vocal portion of the community saying, hey, where the hell is our money going? I want a refund, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So they said, you know, we did promise transparency. Let us try and give you transparency.
Yeah.
Here's a report. We're going to do this weekly. And every week they would put out that report and then it became monthly once Arena Commander came out. So that was long ago in a galaxy far, far away when the UK was still united.
Sorry. Yeah. And then we have the single... And then we have the single weekly reports now, which sort of feed into that monthly report.
Mm-hmm.
So ATV has that segment. So following that, we have the one that Lisa pioneered before she left, the ship shape.
Yeah.
And the idea behind that was, well, we have the ship pipeline, and everyone's always saying we want to see earlier and earlier versions of the ship. We don't want to see the polished stuff.
I want to see a gray box. A gray box in space with no detail whatsoever. That is the ship that I want to see.
I mean, and that was the first Caterpillar.
Yes, really. Absolutely true.
The first Caterpillar thing they showed in that was a gray box floating in a white space. And you know what? That's exactly what people were asking for. It was the early ship stuff. So that's where you get this debate. Well, is it just ship porn? Do you have... You have half the people who hate seeing these early ship concepts and think that seeing nothing but ships is stupid. And you have half the people who are saying, I really enjoy seeing ships. Why are you not showing ships on ATV?
It's so a diverse audience, right? How do you make everybody happy? Not just that's two sides of the coin, but there's actually six sides to this coin. It's a D20. Who knows what we're looking at here?
Yeah. So the bigger question isn't whether they should have ship shape. Because ship shape is something that was very carefully asked for and planned. The question is, how do they balance ship shape against the monthly reports or the weekly reports from the studios and the weekly report from Ben and Sandy, just the summary? People who are complaining about not seeing enough meat and potatoes are complaining that the studio reports aren't revealing enough stuff that they don't want to show, and that Ben and Sandy aren't then revealing a bunch more stuff that they don't want to show.
Really, it boils down to a complaint that there's not enough new stuff being developed every week. And that's a legitimate, if you're trying to make a show interesting, that's a legitimate complaint. Like, people go to watch those shows because they want to learn the exciting new things that are coming. And if those things aren't available because they haven't been developed yet, you can't create a show around them.
Or worse, there is a worse problem, and that problem is on the attempt for the chairman. They've asked the same goddamn question and answered it.
It should have been three
times
for the chairman. Yeah. Then we'd still have some questions worth asking.
Yes.
Well,
yes.
as we were noting, we have a real luxury here on Tales of Citizens. We can do a show once a month. And that's considered pretty okay. Everyone complains, yes, but it's considered okay.
Considered CIG, by us to be okay.
If CIG were to cut from... Yeah, if CIG were to cut their shows from once a week to once a month, the outcry...
You didn't deliver what I promised, goddammit!
Exactly.
Yeah. But yeah. That's... You know what? For would watch that show. I don't watch the show because 90% of it is fluff that I don't care about. Well, if they could take all four of those weeks and boil best stuff down to one show, it would be worth watching.
And you know what that's called?
Tales of Citizens.
The monthly report.
There you go. Yeah, monthly report. That's right.
Which is all written and is very easy to parse and read and understand what's going
on. And has links to all of the exact, like, if they worked on the Caterpillar, they will have a link to the video at the time spot of that Caterpillar. It is exactly what people who want a Too Long Didn't Read want to read. And most of them don't. But when we look at... When we look at ATV and we look at Reverse the Verse as the weekly content sections, and of course 10 for the chairman or 10 for the artists or whatever it is, they're in a really tough spot. And I do feel for them on that.
Mm.
I don't know what the solution is for them. I know that people who are subscribing and feeling that they should be getting, you know, more information on procedurally generated planets or more information on procedurally generated systems or whatever happens to be, won't be satisfied unless they see that specific topic.
And the argument, 1-2-7.
And the argument that they're making is an interesting one. They should be seeing the progression of every system as that progression is happening very transparently.
Here's
and I
the
don't
thing,
know
though,
if I agree with that.
I don't agree with that for the simple reason that there's only so much that an outside person can do without directly interacting with and therefore impacting the productivity of the designers, the artists, the modelers, the animators. They can only do so much to make content for the community to show these transparent things without taking time away from producing the game. Because in order to learn all the details to then transcribe them and tell them to people, they have to pull somebody aside and say, hey, what have you been doing recently so I can transparently convert it to what these people are doing? And that information has to be given out in like 5 minutes because you can't pull those guys aside for 6 hours, you know, or for an hour each, but you got to do that to like 17 different people to get different things. That's a big problem. If you want complete and utter full transparency, every modeler and every programmer has to spend time writing up what they've been doing. And that's just a ginormous waste of time.
It's the sprint. For those of you who are developers or want to know anything about development, this is agile. You're talking about the amount of time you have to spend in meetings every week in order to follow whatever your system is on progress updates. And it can be hell. Agile can be very, very good. And Agile can provide some really great bonuses to making sure that you're delivering and delivering to customers who in this case are indeed your literal customers. But you can end up spending an extra, you know, 5+ hours a week, whatever it ends up being, if you're on short sprints, which if they're on a week sprint with the system, they would be just creating those deliverables and saying, well, I have to be able to demo this at the end of the week.
Yeah. So there's somebody, K-Bomb in the YouTube chat said, it would be like this situation. Hey, Mr. Baker, you're making a cake. Why aren't you telling us more about what's going on in the oven? And then the baker says, because nothing has changed in the last 5 minutes since you asked me. It's still baking.
Though, to be fair, if we're going to extend the YouTube comments reference here, Toby Lewin says he's on the ship's team. And, you know, we can go verify that later. Assuming that's true, and I believe you, Toby, so don't get mad at me. But it's going to be great when it comes out. Just trust me on this. I'm a goddamn baker.
Yeah. Yeah, no, you're not wrong. And... I mean, transparency, they have been more transparent than any other game design company I've ever seen anywhere, ever, period.
So far, yeah, absolutely.
The amount of stuff that we're learning compared to other places is insane. And in some ways, it's too much. It seems to me like it's negatively impacting, even if it's only a little bit, I think it would be negatively impacting their progress to some degree to see so many people get a look at pre-release content and then react negatively to it. That doesn't help you when you already know it's bad. You're like, yes, I know, we're still working on it. Stop judging me, right?
Please.
We're not at the Olympics yet. I still have time to practice.
Yeah. It's ultimately, no one wants to see how the sausage is made. And when they do finally see people stuffing meat into the lining, they're unhappy about it. But sausage in the end is still pretty goddamn good when you get down to it. So it's, yeah.
So you're right. And it is just like not wanting to see what the sausage looks like when it's being made. But at the same time, hopefully it opens up some people's eyes. Because the number of people, by the way, who had some pet feature that was not included. I'm going back to Hearts of Iron 4 because I've been following the forums like a freaking ferret for the last 20 years. The number of people that would be like, why doesn't it have feature X? This is clearly a very important feature present in many other games, and I think it should be in there. It's like, okay, why doesn't it have feature important to me? I think it should be important. Okay, yeah, you say feature X, other people say feature Y, somebody else says feature Z, and the developer said, you know what, we're going to try to fix the AI first. How about we do that, and then maybe we'll look at adding the feature that only 2% of our audience is going to use. There's like all kinds, like the people are like, I can't believe they would ship a game that doesn't allow me to move the camera with WASD. And I'm thinking to myself, that is probably the last thing they have on their priority list right now. The AI is broken and we're trying to make it better. Like having one of their programmers completely set it aside for 6 hours, or it probably takes way longer than 6 hours. I'm being way optimistic here that it would take 6 hours. And try to fix that system.
You also thought the 1,000 pounds club meant you could bench 1,000 pounds. So we accept this.
We forgive you.
It's a joke. Hashtag gotcha. So there. But you know, that's what I'm saying. Even if it only took an hour, the feature that that's very important to this person, and I would use it too. I'm not saying it's a bad idea. The feature is very important to that person is still on a priority list somewhere, and you don't get to everything. And so when you look at people and they're like, they think game design is so easy. They think features just make their way in, and they are astonished when 9 out of 10 games have feature X, and the game that they're playing right now doesn't have feature X. And they're like, this is very important. I can't believe. And you know what? People call them lazy. They're like, these developers, it's simply lazy to not include this feature is lazy. And I think, and this is what I typed to them. I said, excuse me, do you think that developers went into the office and said, well, I could put in this feature for this guy that really wants it, but instead, I'm just going to take a nap. Like, is that what they did? That was me, by the way, being an internet guy.
When you become internet guy, though, it reminds me of a very popular streamer, Mathis Games. He sounds just like that in real life. So that's impressive.
That was a mistake. I don't. I mean, no offense.
That was not on purpose.
No, but that's my point. Is that people? So this is, I think, a piece of the fundamental attribution error, which is people attribute the issues in their games to the designers because that's the only person they have to blame. When really, it's just that they don't understand. And I give the designers the benefit of the doubt most of the time, unless there was something where they clearly chose to do something stupid, like PlanetSide 2, instead of doing something smart. Then I don't give them benefit of the doubt anymore. But if they didn't include something and it's not necessarily a super important critical thing, I think to myself, yeah, they probably just didn't get to it. And it's on a priority list somewhere, maybe something they'll add in a patch. But it's not because they were lazy. That envision just bugs me. Anyway, that was a new second Bridger rant without the backup music.
We get two.
You got two this week.
You've had a while. You get two. That's our rule.
And I don't want to be defending Bridger. CIG because maybe they are being bad at things. I just
no. We're not defending CIG.
We get accused though of like being CIG fanboys right all the time. Okay. But really, I'm just giving them the benefit of the doubt. If when the game comes out, it's crap, I'm going to call it crap. No question. Right now, it is kind of crap, but I'm giving it a break because it's an alpha.
Come on,
said Hearts of Iron 4 had terrible AI, but you love the game.
I can criticize it, and I still that's right.
CIG has a product that is legitimately pretty.
Yeah.
They have a product that I can fly my ship around in. They have a product where, you know, aside from having a missile splash into my cockpit and kick the shit out of me, I really enjoy actually flying these ships. And they have a product where I can watch Bridger get rammed by the AI because the AI knows it will win.
Do Do not search for that term on Google.
Yeah. I think that the fact of the matter is, even for just this alpha stage, they have a good product. And they have a product that's improving.
Yeah.
Really, really well. Really well incrementally, for that matter.
Right. Oh, you know, that's the other thing I wanted to point out, is part of this problem with the content seeming to be mostly filler now is it's as compared to the earlier part of the process where Wingman would bring people on to explain the vision of the game. And at the time, we didn't know much about the vision of the game, right?
They
we
were didn't describing know... the basics.
Yeah, they were describing all the basics. But now that they finished telling us all the basics, now they have to show us the actual game being created. And that's a much slower process than just telling us all the stuff that they've got lined up. So it seemed like we were getting so much more before. And then when we got Arena Commander, we were getting so much more before. And then we hit this period where a lot of stuff is being built in the behind the scenes. And later it's all going to come together and be this big thing. But at the moment, it's a doldrum of information. And that's all I have to say about that.
That's a bigger word than I expected from you, Bridger. Thank you.
It's a perfectly cromulent word.
It is a wonderfully cromulent word, yeah.
A marvelously cromulent word.
And Sebusca means roadhog in Spanish. That's actually a Overwatch reference there.
Why do you know that?
It doesn't. It means wanted man. It's like, you know, a wanted poster. But I was in a Discord chat with somebody who's playing it. And he said, you know, Sebusca means roadhog in Spanish. And then, to my eternal glory, I said, yes. Yes, it does. And you hear dead silence in the chat. It was beautiful.
All right, so I don't want to drag this out. I mean, we're just making the same points again and again. And that just drags the show on. Yeah. So any final thoughts on this or anything else that we talked about here tonight?
Where's my
Play 2-4. If you haven't gotten the chance yet, play 2-4. You will not regret it.
Unless you don't have your control set up yet.
And no. Do it even then and set your controls up. Spend the 6 to 12 hours that will take.
No.
If your controls aren't set up, you go into single player Vandal Swarm. Actually. And because when you go into escape, when you hit escape in Vandal Swarm, everything pauses, so you can go back and check stuff, and you can test, because you need to do it in Vandal Swarm. You can't do it in Free Flight, because you need to test all the targeting and things like that.
That's
the thing, right? So, the first level of Vandal Swarm is simple. They can't hit the broadside of a barn anyway.
Yeah.
Even if you're standing still.
That said, there is actually one thing to think about, which is with the release of the Vive, which you can buy right now, and the Oculus Rift Consumer Edition comes out shortly. Where are we going with support on the VR headsets, augmented reality, and head tracking software, which was kind of but not quite supported in earlier versions and is, from what I understand, mostly gone now?
No, there was a video somebody did. It was, hang on, let me, there it is, playing Star Citizen in VR on the HTC Vive, and he gives his initial thoughts. And so somebody figured out a way to do it.
Well, that was that before. That was Vin had it on the Rift too.
Sure,
it's the virtual desktop.
Yep,
I think that's probably the same.
So it's not quite native support,
right?
Yeah,
but to be honest, I kind of expect that. because it's a first person universe. The Vive and or Oculus Rift and or other equivalent hardware.
Yeah,
it's gonna be one of the best ways to experience the game because of all of the trouble and time and effort that the CIG is going into making this a immersive thing. They're trying to make sure all the game menus, you know, all the things that you interact with feel like you're interacting with the world. Like Mobi Glass is a thing that you wear on your arm. It's not just a menu that pops up that looks like a menu and rather than being something in real life. That's great.
And nothing's more immersive than, you know, groping blindly for your controls while wearing a headset.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So my point is,
this is why I have to learn to do everything blind already.
Yes.
My keyboard is already Braille, guys.
So you're saying that people who are blind have an advantage when they're playing with the
Vive. Yes, I am.
Or maybe only people who are sighted,
the one-eyed man is king.
Yes.
I'm going to venture to say that I could find a blind person who will ram AI less frequently than Bridger.
That's probably true.
I was testing my controls, damn it. I had no strafe. No strafe, do you hear me? The sea was angry that day, my friends. So anyway,
Get out there, play 2.4. Don't be Bridger. Realize there's a magnifying glass you can use.
The point I was trying to make is, despite the fact that VR is going to be the main one of the best ways to enjoy these types of games in the future, there's a very small market of it right now, and it's probably there's lower like on the people. Priority list. It's way lower on the priority list than people with Vives want it to be. Right? They want it to be way higher. Yes. Everybody else is like, no,
I want it
make
now.
The game work for me on my monitor first, then you can make it work for them. But in reality, we'll see them probably get some support in the next year or so, natively. Yeah.
Yes. Though that said, I still enjoy throwing that concern out there, and we'll do so until it's released. You know, I'm going to support my VR brothers and sisters. Viva la Androids. Wait, no, that sounds like a Google plug. Let's try that again. Viva the Robots? No. Robot 2016. There you go.
So, and I talked about how I felt the Oculus was one step away from a visual hardware standpoint from being, like, really good. Like, you could just still see the screen door effect. If you were looking when you first got into it, you could definitely tell that there was a screen door effect. It kind of went away when I was actually playing. I stopped noticing it. And one more iteration that increases the resolution will probably be enough to really make them there, right? They're going to be equivalent to like a 4K monitor where people are going, this looks amazing. I'm hoping for that anyway. So,
we'll see.
I'm still trying to convince myself to hold out on the Vive until Vive 2.0. I just got to do it.
I have the ultimate way to convince you to do that. $800.
No. $1,600, because I'll have to buy a computer to use it in the room upstairs.
Okay.
Because this room I'm in isn't big enough for the Vive. to walk around
into you,
the
it's very spacious.
Oh, yeah, no, you're
got
right.
A whole shit back there.
It's very dangerous. lots of buttons you can hit by accident. Anyway,
so $1,600 should be the biggest
deterrent.
Yeah, yeah, you're right. It is actually the only thing that's stopping me right now. But with
I had that same thought, and then I look in around the room here that I play games in when I play games. And realize if I were to do that, I would have to clear out about 90% of this room to get the right.
Yeah, no,
space.
I'm thinking of I'd have to put it in the living room. Actually, we have a decent sized living room. We'd move the couch out of the way. It would be a whole thing. But then it occurred to me I'd have to drag it up and downstairs anyway if I wanted to use it to play Star Citizen down here. Then I'd have to drag it up there if we wanted to do a room thing. It's gonna be.
So that said, I'm in Southern California, so in theory, I could just do it outside.
Yeah. True enough. All right.
That would work.
On that note, thanks, guys, for tuning in to Tales of Citizens. This very derailed version of the show
We've been gone for a while.
We're getting back into the swing of things.
Feedback at talesofshow.com if you'd like to rant at us.
That's right. Feedback at talesofshow.com. And we will.
If you can. And if you're on mobile and watching us on YouTube, take the landscape version and turn it so it's portrait, and then the upvote magically appears and press that. I have been mystified by that for some time and learned it just recently. It's beautiful.
There you go. How to Use a Phone by Calathulu. Signing off. Turning a phone changes the orientation, you say?
It actually exposes the buttons, too.
Yes.
That's the part that got me. I was like, why can't I can't press anything to get an upvote or, you know, the like button. But by God, if I turn my phone, the like button appears. I'm like, what is this?
Yeah. No, you're
terrible
not wrong.
Job.
You're not wrong. It works. You know, like I was more excited than I should have been when YouTube app added the ability to full screen a portrait video. Right? Am I the only one who got excited when that happened? You know what I'm talking about?
Probably, yes. Actually, you were the only one to get excited. No, it was pretty cool. Though I'm going to say right now, the YouTube gaming app absolutely blows.
Does it?
I cannot use it to save my life. It's awful.
I don't use it.
The actual YouTube app is more functional than viewing gaming, which I have to do for most of my Heroes of the Storm, since I get to play about 3 games a week at this point. So I watch MF Pally Time and Kaldor and some of the other ones when I get a chance. And
so what about the YouTube gaming app makes it worse than the YouTube app?
Well, it crashes about half the time on the Samsung S6 Edge.
Yeah, that'd do it.
So I haven't tried it an awful lot, but I'm just going to try to pull it up.
So I'm going to say don't is the answer there. And if it works for you, great. But for me, it's been a huge pain in the ass. To the point that, you can't even, some of these different groups have multicam. Speaking of, we need to at some point actually sit down and play some games together. Not necessarily Star Citizen, though Star Citizen, we've tried that and it works well. But just a few games in general to see how bad we are.
Sure.
We could.
You know what? I've been meaning to pick up Twilight Struggle. Although that's not a good stream game, probably.
That sounds like some kind of non-consent game.
No, it's a quote by Kennedy about the Cold War.
Okay, well, I'm going to say the Kennedy assassination was not consensual. See, the great Gray laughs because he knows the formula, which is tragedy times time equals humor.
True. So, no,
that is a valid formula.
Twilight Struggle is a two-player board game that has recently had a release on Steam and iOS, and it is...
I actually already have that.
Oh, you got that? Steam.
Yeah, oh, we got to play it sometime. Really, it's really good. Too. I haven't gotten to even play the AI yet.
It's an extremely good game. And I don't know if I've talked about it before on the show, but it's a perfect melding of mechanics and narrative. Ludo-narrative consistency, I guess, is the term. Because somebody coined the term ludo-narrative dissonance to describe when a game's mechanics and its narrative theme differ very widely. So this one has them matching up really well, and that's what makes the game work. And the way that I've always explained it is the game is essentially a card management game. It's about the Cold War. One side plays the USSR, one side plays the US, and you both draw cards from the same deck. The cards are either pro-Soviet events, or they are pro-US events, or they are neutral events that can be used by either party. So you're going to draw your opponent's events sometimes into your hand, and your opponent is going to draw your events sometimes into your hand. So it's about mitigating these disastrous things in your hand, because when you play an event, a card that has your opponent's event on it, the event happens and your opponent gets that good thing, but then you as compensation get some operation points to spend. But when you play these cards and in what order help, you got to figure out how to best negate the damage that's going to be caused by these different things. So one of the other types of cards are scoring cards. These are how you get victory points. So each region in the planet has a scoring card. Europe scoring card, Middle East scoring card, Asia scoring card, Africa scoring card, etc. Now, Europe is most important. You get the most points for. Then Asia, then the Middle East, then Africa, South Africa, and Central America, or South America and Central America. They are all kinds of mixed together. But here's the thing about these scoring cards. Let's say it's the mid-war, and you both have just drawn a fresh hand of cards, and you know that some of the scoring cards are out there, and the first thing your opponent does is put some influence in Vietnam. And you're like, huh.
As you would.
Yeah, you might. So you go, huh, I wonder why he's doing that. And then you play a card doing something else, and the second thing he does is he puts some influence in Thailand. And you're like, uh-oh, I bet he has the Asia scoring card. He's trying to bolster up his points there so that when he plays it, he'll win. So I'm going to put some influence in Vietnam to try and cancel his. And then your opponent, who doesn't have the Asia scoring card but sees you trying to counter his moves in Asia, goes, oh, I bet he has the Asia scoring card. And now you're both putting points into Vietnam even though neither of you care, and it doesn't matter. In the end... You're only there because your opponent is there, and that's a perfect description of what happened in the Cold War in Vietnam.
Yeah,
holy crap!
It is, actually.
There are a few cards that let you see your opponent's hand or see whether they've got scoring cards and things like that, but a lot of the time it's trying to discern what your opponent has in their hand from how they're playing and trying to throw your opponent off and bluff what you're doing, and it's a really cool game. But that mechanic mix where you're both fighting over an area that doesn't matter because both of you have assumed that the other person had it. It doesn't happen often, but when it happens and you finish using all the cards and you're like, oh, neither of us had South America scoring this turn. Why
neither
are we
of us
both
cares,
doing
but
this?
My God.
Yeah. It's really cool. It's really cool.
That sounds like fun. There are actually a few board games I've seen recently that are like, they are designed as board games, but they go straight to Steam. Like, never actually hit the board.
Like Tharsis, is that board. One? With the dice?
Tharsis was one of them, and then Thea, The Awakening, and Armello.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I got Armello for my wife. Game. Yeah. Because she see, the thing is, I thought it had a little bit more narrative to it, but it was more like a board game, like a replayable board game.
Yeah.
And so she liked playing it the one time, but she didn't like that it didn't have more of a narrative to it. She really likes games that have a strong narrative.
And I've played it a few times. It's really good.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's well designed. This should have been a board game, but I guess it's cheaper to get it onto Steam.
Well, so, in some ways,
there's a concern. Do we see the death of the board game coming?
No, not at all. Because there are some things that those games do that if you made it into a board game, and God, talking about things that the computers can do that would just be so mind-numbingly boring if you turn it into a board game, but people have made those, and it was in the 80s, and they were called war games that were just so much fiddly record-keeping to keep track of the super complex systems. You spend more time moving sliders just to track special tracks and numbers than you did actually playing the game and making decisions. And when you put those games on a computer, you get to have really complex interactions. Like Hearts of Iron has super complex systems that you could never put into a board game because the tracking of all them would be very difficult.
Not that the Battle for Britain didn't try, what with his 500 individual records being kept of each plane involved in the combat.
Yeah. When I did a talk at Kineticon, which is a local gaming convention here, I wanted to talk about war games, and sort of one of the things that I talked about was the scale of war games and how you can have light to complex, and you can have ones that focus really low on like squad level, and then you can go up to company level or operational, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah.
And so part of that was I wanted to find like simple and quick versus super complex monster war games that take weeks and weeks and weeks to finish. And I've talked about these before on the show, but the one that I wanted to find, what is the one, the biggest one that has ever been made? It was the Battle for North Africa, I want to say. This is a thing that has a campaign that stretches for several thousand hours, to the point where the original creators only ever finished it once. It's so complicated. Like, it goes it goes hour by hour, day by day kind of a thing. It's super, super, super tiny details. I would never play something quite that difficult, but I do play these ones that take a few sessions to complete, like the 50-hour war games. I have played those. That's my limit.
Yeah, that's. I mean, I did a ton of tabletop gaming, the strategy games where you do a ton of record keeping, but I've never gone to the 50-hour thing. That would kill me.
No.
Oh, no, I take that back. That's not true. Mighty Empires, the old Games Workshop board game. It was kind of like the strategic level of their fantasy battle tabletop. So way back when, they had a fully developed set of rules for that instead of the really cheesy ones they kind of made later on, and you could play that game for literally weeks, because if you had two of your armies meet in the field, you could then go play a tabletop game of fantasy battle.
Right.
Record the results and then bring that back to the board games.
And there's a war game version of that. And now the name of it is escaping me. It's a World War II World in Flames. Have this strategic game that you can, like, it's primarily a miniatures game, but they built a strategic level game, and that when a battle triggers, you like, okay, let's put the strategic game on hold, and now we're going to go fight this miniatures battle that takes an hour, and then we'll come back, like Total War style.
Yeah, and we ended up doing this this thing at the local gaming store where we had, I don't know, 40 players. And so we would make allegiances, and like, I was the high elves and I was allied with one chaos group for a while. And
man,
like,
those can be really fun.
A lot of fun. The whole thing lasted 6 months.
Dang,
we did one turn a week.
Impressive.
Wow.
Yeah. One turn a week. Everyone started next to each other. So we were fighting immediately. It was really entertaining.
So the other, what game I'm really looking forward to? You guys have heard of the legacy game movement in the board gaming thing?
No, not
Risk Legacy. No.
No.
So
no.
Rob Davio is a game designer, and he built Risk Legacy a little while ago. And let me see if I can find some pictures of it. Because the idea here was he wanted to essentially create a game that evolved, and I'll throw some pictures up here, create a game that evolved as you played it, which means, so you've got a game of Risk, right? This is the standard Risk that everybody knows and loves, except the board changes over time. The players' nations that they are playing as change. Mm-hmm. Huh. Every game, something new happens. You see in the board, in the box in the background there, there's like some packets of envelopes that are taped to the box. Mm-hmm. When X happens, open this envelope. In there will be new stickers that you paste into the rule book in blank sections that have been left for them that change the rules to the game. Like, you know, after you've played three games, atomic weapons become available or something to that effect. Let me see here. So it's like, open when one person gets to sign the board a second time. So every time you win, you get to put a little sticker on the board and name one of the places that you control. And for the rest of the game, that place is named Ball Sackatopia, right? So you're physically altering the board. You're putting stickers onto cards that represent your nation because you're getting a special power for the rest of the game. Your nation now has bonuses with tanks or whatever special thing. So this was Risk Legacy. It was this thing that changed over time, and it had all these very specific conditions, and they even went so far as to like hide stuff under the box. And I wonder if any of these pictures show it, but like people like didn't know until they had this very specific condition where there was like a thing with an envelope hidden all the way underneath. So then this went from Risk Legacy, and here's torn up cards because sometimes you're supposed to tear up stuff when it says you have to make a choice, pick one or the other.
I hope you print things first.
So anyway, the concept of legacy games where you only kind of play them through this little campaign one time and then it's done. Like the game is, but here's Risk Legacy is great because you can still play with this board. You can still play with these sides. They've changed over time, but that's great. So then he made Pandemic Legacy. Pandemic is a game you might have heard of. Pandemic is this game where everybody's working for the CDC and they're trying to solve these outbreaks across the world. It's a co-op spread game, right? He made Pandemic Legacy, and in this one, it's literally a game you can only play through, I think it's 12 to 24 times, because every time you lose, you can replay that same scenario one more time to try and fix it, basically. But it's 12 to 24 times, and when you're done, you're done. You can't really replay it again, because all the things that would have been set up in those specific things are gone. And there's like a very linear story as you're going through this. That, now we're learning more about the outbreak, we're learning more about this, and I won't spoil it for people because it does have very specific, interesting ways that it turns. But now, that was Rob Davio as well, and now he's making a game called Seafall. This is a take. Why is the developer console open? I did not do that. Oh, yes, I did. I hit it F11 before. F12 is developer console. Anyway, this is a game that uses a 4X style explore expand style game, right? But more like Merchants and Marauders if you ever played that, and turns this into a legacy game. This has 15 games and then you're done, but each game is like 2 to 3 hours, and you know what, there are games on my shelf that I haven't played 15 times, and if everybody involved pitches in $20, then you get it. Boom. Everybody pays $20, you spend maybe 30 hours or more playing this game, then that's really good value, right? This is not a game that one person buys and then owns. This is a campaign game. Everybody's in it together, like a D&D campaign. So you can see, if you look at this thing, everybody's got their own little home province here where their ships come back to repair, and you can attack other people's provinces, and you can see that your little home province board here has buildings and stuff that you can get, and you can get special custom things that you can put on your guys that you unlock and for talents and stuff like that. But the rest of this board is unexplored. This is all unexplored territory. All of these things here are islands that have yet to be found. And it's like you'll paste them onto here, and when people explore things, you then take a sticker and you permanently put, here's where you can get a source of cloth, or here's where you can get a source of, you know, tea or whatever this trading good is. So the game permanently changes over time, and I'm really excited. It's coming in August, I think, late August, early September. So it seems going to be a lot of fun.
That should be fun. I could go down for that.
Yep. They need more of these kinds of games. But, man, it takes a long time to make them. It takes a long time to make them.
Well, it does. But the good news is that the gaming community has grown so much in the last, I don't know, 10, 20 years, that small niche games like that actually do get audiences big enough to pay for them.
Yeah,
so to
absolutely.
Me, that's pretty cool.
I mean, Pandemic Legacy is super, super popular with people, despite the fact that Pandemic itself is just such a boring game to me. I know that people love it, and that's great, and I'm glad they're having fun, but God, is that game not challenging at all. Or if it is challenging, it's because the random luck of the draw. It's basically luck. Once you grok the game, it's up just down to luck. And... I don't know. I never felt like, and maybe it was just a bad one. I only had one experience with it. I'm completely open to the fact that maybe it was just a bad experience, and maybe it's different with you're playing with different groups of people. But man, we played it, and it was just every decision I had to make was super obvious. Like I wasn't even torn. Like, oh, it could be this or this. I'm not sure which is better. Like that's when you know a game is good, is when you're torn on which thing is supposed to be better.
To pick either one. Yeah.
I never felt it. Yeah, there's people in the chat going, you mean board games got more complicated than Monopoly? there's people that don't know. Like, there's this thriving board game universe that is very interesting and complex.
Oh, yeah.
Let me see if I can find that game I was talking about. Monster War Game North Africa. I think that's what it was called. Let me see.
Monster War Game North Africa.
The Campaign for North Africa. Boom. Found it. This is the actual image that I used. It's showing a child for scale.
Child
this
for
is before
scale.
They
yeah.
used bananas for scale. This looks to be about 6-7 feet long.
Nice.
And maybe 3 feet wide. That's a lot of hexes.
That would be a lot of hexes. We would spend many a year playing that game.
The Campaign for North Africa. Let me see what the official playing time is on the Board Game Geek. 60,000 minute playing time. 60,000.
Measure that in minutes?
Because they measure everything in minutes, because they didn't think they'd need to go over like 600. 600 minutes is like 10 hours, right? All right. 60.
Wow.
1, 2, 3 divided by 60 gives us 1,000 hours. I should have been able to do that in my head. That was kind of sad.
Good God.
Yeah, 1,000-hour game.
Who has that kind of time?
Right.
Nobody has that kind of time.
That's a game you play over years. But you
Ain't
know what?
Ain't nobody got time for that.
You know what?
Basically.
I don't feel like the campaign in
no
North
adult.
Africa is worthy of a game that long. I can't imagine how interesting it is.
The campaign in North Africa lasted 60,000 minutes. Let's be
right?
clear about that.
Real time.
I mean, if you demoted that to like Caesar's campaigns in Gaul, or you devoted that amount of time to the Eastern Front of World War II, these were epic conflicts that I could see spending that much time in detail on. But the campaign for North Africa?
Just to be clear, that is 42 contiguous days of playing that game.
That's more than a year and a half of playing it like almost full time, right?
If you were playing an hour a day, that would be... Okay, 42 contiguous days, 1 hour per day. So let's multiply that out times... I can't even times 23... You'd have about 3 years of playtime if you did an hour a day.
All right, let me see. Where is
Good gods.
Me?
All right, no, we're not doing that.
Let's see. Let me show off my collection, my Board Game Geek collection here, if it comes up correctly. There it is.
Yeah, I actually got called a troll and spammer on Board Game Geek.
You did?
Yeah, because there was a guy who posted a review on Elf Ball, a tiny little niche game made as a response to Blood Bowl. When Games Workshop dropped support.
Yeah, okay.
And I gave a review, and I said, I read all the reviews on there about it and thought, this does not represent the game at all. This is ridiculous. So I made a review. I didn't comment or didn't talk about anybody. And I said, look, I'm not sure what people are playing, but this game is only loosely related to Blood Bowl in that both are fantasy, fantasy-themed sports games. Beyond that, there's no similarity. I mean, this is more like rugby than anything. And someone read that and got upset and reported me. Oh, it was beautiful. It was one of the experience.
Ah, Well, at least you had fun then.
I did. I mean, I got to troll somebody, which is always a good time. Apparently. I didn't mean to, so I guess it's even better.
Ah.
The inadvertent troll.
Is that what they call us?
Trollish is the troll that trolls on its own.
Wow. Now we're getting real,
it's trollception territory.
Trollception.
Thank you.
Actually, I need to fix this. I've actually sold a bunch of these games already, but this is... Combat Commander. That's my desert island game.
Like, you're lost on a desert island and there's no one to play yourself.
Well, no. If you have to be stuck on a desert island and you can only bring one game, that's the one I bring. It's an awesome game. It's only a two-player game, so hopefully I'm only lost on the island with one other person who likes war games about World War II. But you know.
Well, the other person who's there with you can survive.
Yeah.
They can build a shelter and get food while you play your game.
Spyfall is really interesting. This is a light game where there are probably 30 or so little baggies, and inside each bag is a deck of like 8 cards. One of them on the back has a spy. The others all show a picture of a location. So you hand out these cards and you make sure the spy is in one of them. And everybody on the table gets a card. And so let's say it's a circus is the location. And you pick up your card and it says circus and it shows a picture of a circus. And then at the bottom it says, ringleader. And then another one says lion tamer. Another one says concession stand owner. And then the spy looks at his card. It just says spy. The spy's job is to figure out where he is. Everybody else's job is to figure out who the spy is. So the spy doesn't know that you're in a circus because there's like 30 different places, like circus, train, pirate ship, crusade. Like there's tons of different locations. So the game mechanics are the person who dealt out the cards, who has a card himself, asks somebody a question. And then the person they asked now has to ask somebody else a question who wasn't the one who asked them. And it just keeps going around like that for 8 minutes. And so somebody asked the spy, do you know where the restrooms are? And the spy goes, they're
in the lion tamer's car.
The other car, because he thinks he's on a train. And everybody goes, oh, that's the spy. Like, but if he says something super generic, they might think he's the spy too. And yet at the same time, if you're not a spy, you're trying so hard to not give away information. So you maybe will ask a question that's relevant to a subset of the things, right? Like, what time do you think we'll get there? Because that could be a train, it could be the boat, it could be the plane, it could be a bunch of different things. Or it could be you're on a rocket ship. Like, there's a bunch of different things. So you try to craft these questions in a way, and everybody's trying to answer them in a way that's also vague, but yet proves that they know what you know about where you are. It's a pretty crazy game.
That sounds really good, actually. That sounds like
a light game. It's a bit of fun.